I'd like to welcome you all to Oxford for this conference on what is a rare morning in the Thames Valley. We're seeing, I think for the first time since a drought was predicted, the sun, which does indicate some of the perils of prediction, which I'm going to say a word about in a moment. I'm proud and privileged to be able to welcome you this morning, even though it's in this room, which has pretty grim associations for all those of us who were educated at Oxford University. Not very long ago, it seems, that I was trying to wrestle with the causes of the 30 Years' War in this room, which didn't incidentally include resources, but more of resources and conflict in a moment. Anyway, I'm delighted to be here and proud to be here, both because of the importance of the subject matter and because of the distinction of the participants. It's obviously invidious to single out any individuals, but any meeting which includes a brace of presidents is always likely to be of considerable interest. I want to express my gratitude to the Rothschild Foundation and to the Smith School of Enterprise and the Environment for organizing and hosting the conference. And I'd like to thank all my academic colleagues from the university, from the James Martin School, from the Blavatnik School, and from elsewhere, who are taking part in the conference. Now, I don't need Copernicus to tell me that I'm not the center of the universe. So please forgive at the outset a piece of shameless autobiography. Governments in Western democracies haven't been taking the environment and resource issues as seriously as they should for very long. In this country, a defining moment was 1989, and the moment owed a great deal to the fact that the Green Party did extremely well in the elections to the European Parliament, the mother-in-law of all parliaments. One consequence was that I was asked to become the Secretary of State for the Environment and to do something about the rise of the Greens. And I think there were two reasons for me being asked to become Environment Secretary. The first was that I'd actually made some speeches about the environment and about the environmental aspects of development assistance when I was Minister for Overseas Development. That was partly a result of seeing some of the consequences of awful agricultural and environmental policies in the drought-stricken Sahel and in flooded Bangladesh. Again and again, we found ourselves dealing with humanitarian catastrophes, which were the result of extreme environmental stress. But another reason, which was pretty clear, was that there was a general view at that time that environment and environmental matters were principally of interest to the kind of people, I see few of them before me today, who wore sandals, taught at polytechnics, and had pretty wishy-washy views about the world. And since I was regarded as being so wet that you could shoot snipe off me, I was obviously regarded as a suitable candidate for dealing with the issue. To be fair, the then Prime Minister was, I think, one of the few politicians in those days who understood and took seriously the issue of climate change, the greenhouse effect, and so on. I guess one of the benefits of studying chemistry as she did at this university. And she was also prepared to take seriously the work of Professor David Pearce, who I brought into the Department of the Environment as my personal advisor. David Pearce, who some of you will have known and worked with, died 7 years ago. He was a pioneer of environmental economics, educated here at Lincoln College, and professor at several universities, including UCL. David Pearce provided rigorous arguments for basing policy on the criterion of sustainability. Sustainability memorably described in the Brundtland Commission report as development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. David Pearce showed how it was possible to value environmental effects and to make use of market incentives. He provided, I think, the innovative thinking that enabled us to reconcile market economics and good environmental policy. He didn't suggest that you could always prevent economic activity from damaging the environment, but he believed that through measuring environmental damage, you could work towards defining the minimum conditions for such damage to be accepted, and in that way, maintain the inheritance of physical capital, of intellectual capital, and environmental capital for future generations. The market-based policies that he advocated provided, of course, an attractive route for investment by both the private and the public sectors. We managed to introduce a lot of David Pearce's arguments into a white paper that we produced on the environment back in 1990, though only, alas, thanks to the intervention of the Treasury, in an appendix. The best statement of David Pearce's views came in the manifesto that he published himself with some academic colleagues in 1989, Blueprint for a Green Economy. David Pearce's early death was, I think, a heavy loss to public policymaking and economic thought. But I guess that in some ways you'll be drawing on some of his ideas over the next couple of days. At this point, I should, I suppose, genuflect in the direction of the published title of my brief introductory remarks, predicting the interaction of global forces, though not the weather. The problem is that I have difficulty in accepting that we're much good at predicting anything. The first time I saw Shenzhen in southern China, it was in 1979, and it was a sleepy fishing village. Now, as some of you will know, it's Adam Smith out of Hieronymus Bosch. I left Hong Kong in 1997, the day before, not propter hoc, but post hoc, the day before the Asian economy tanked, which nobody predicted. I was a European commissioner back in the days when Germany was often described as the sick man of Europe. So I'm pretty skeptical about our ability to look at the line on the graph paper and assuming that it will continue remorselessly up or down the paper. Alec Cairncross, at one time the economic advisor to the government in this country, and towards the end of his life, the master of St. Peter's College here used to say that a trend is a trend until it bends. On the other hand, I don't agree with Coleridge that the lamp on the back of the ship simply tells you what the waves and the sea were like that you've just passed through. I think we can also get an idea of what the water is like ahead of the ship from what it looks like behind. So I think that a knowledge of history, what's been happening, can give us a reasonably good idea of what is to come. And clearly it's true that we've known for some time the effect that individual resource issues can have. Overall, of course, we know, and it's a point that's been well argued by Professor Paul Collier of this university, overall, of course, we know the extent to which resources can contribute to conflict and to state failure. Similarly, there's a wealth of knowledge about the impact of different resource issues. There's no shortage of studies of the political and economic consequences of our growing dependence on oil, for instance, from explanations for the fall of Mossadegh to Alan Greenspan's argument about the invasion of Iraq being determined by oil. We'd forgotten perhaps until recently, because of a long period of low or falling food prices, that politics and economics revolve around the price and supply of food. The Arabic word for bread means life, and undoubtedly food and food prices have not only caused wars between states, but they've also helped to trigger revolutions. And I don't think that the price of food and the supply of food are irrelevant to what's happened in the Arab world over the last couple of years. Water doesn't produce Malthusian issues of shortage, but the results of maldistribution of supply do threaten the security of states and produce immigration and popular turbulence. And I guess it's not just think tanks in India and China which look at the security implications of water in those countries, particularly the fact that the six most important rivers in those countries both rise on the Himalayan mountain plain. There is, I suppose, one simple issue which it's not alarmist or anti-religious to make. Scientists who dedicate their lives to the study of the mosquito, some scientists, for example, at this university, say that this pest only has two purposes in life, to eat and to copulate. I guess that had the history of our planet been written by a mosquito, the insect might have said the same about Homo sapiens. In the last century, our population has increased by four times, the urban population 13 times, industrial output grew by a factor of 40, energy use 13 times, carbon dioxide emissions 17 times, water use 9 times, the catch of marine fish by 35. The president of the British Academy, Professor Sir Adam Roberts of this university, has many wise sayings, one of which is that the future would be a good subject of study if only the sources were more forthcoming. And I think that is to a considerable extent true. But at least these facts about demography and about resources are clear. And they're the facts that are shaping our world. To cope, we need to harness entrepreneurial energy and market forces, exactly as David Pearce argued. I'm sure that's what you'll be discussing for the next couple of days. These aren't soft issues, the result of pressure from wishy-washy wets. This is, in my view, hardcore economics and hardcore commerce. I think we should realize that the chance of handing on a legacy to the next generation, which is worth having, will depend a great deal on the sort of issues that you'll be discussing over the next 2 days. So once again, my congratulations to those who've put this conference together, who are organizing it. Welcome to all of you who are taking part. The last Smith School conference that I attended, just to demonstrate my interest and commitment to these issues, in order to get there, I had to leave halfway through the fifth set between Federer and Andy Roddick. I was the only man on the center court at Wimbledon to leave when the score was 12-all. So these are hugely important issues. I'd have done the same today for this conference. Congratulations to the organizers, and I hope you have an intellectually stimulating couple of days.